Hey, I'm going to take the liberty today, and I'm going to speak for 90% of the podcast hosts when I say everybody does an episode that is just kind of a fun podcast for them to do. Selfishly for them, for me, I want to do a fun episode in light of the Christmas season, and I think this will be lighthearted, but it'll also have some takeaways that you can apply, that we can all apply. We can plug right into our life in 2022 if we haven't already. But I'm going to have a little fun today. And thank you in advance for giving me the freedom to do that. So I hope you enjoy this. And I want to go through, I'm going to break down to you my favorite Christmas movie. And there's some serious life lessons in this movie. And it's probably not the one you're thinking of either. Everybody says A Christmas Story or A Christmas Carol. And those are not my favorite movies for Christmas time. I'm sorry. But I'm going to break down the top five, in my opinion. And then my favorite one I'm going to go into and unpack for you, because there's some really good meat on the bone as far as life lessons and real life takeaways. So here we go. I want to run down the top five, in my opinion, of top Christmas movies. Number five, we're going to go 5-1, one being the best, of course. So number five, I'm going to say, is called Surviving Christmas. That is with Ben Affleck, and you guys may know it, but it's a great one. It's got James Gandolfini in it, RIP. He left us a few years ago, but Surviving Christmas is number five. Number four would be Will Ferrell, lighting it up, bringing it home in Elf. Some people don't like grown-ups dressed in kids' costumes. I don't particularly either, but that movie is priceless. There's some really good one-liners that my family and I use throughout the season, trust me. Number three, Four Christmases with Vince Vaughn. And you guys know that movie, I hope. If not, we need to check your pulse and get you a television and get you some real life experiences. So Four Christmases with Reese Witherspoon and Vince Vaughn, classic. Welcome to the Octagon, son. That is a line from that movie that we use all the time. It's got Tim McGraw. So yeah, you guys check it out if you haven't already. Number two, I bet you're going to guess. Chevy Chase. That's right. Christmas Vacation, Cousin Eddie. Gotta love them. Gotta love it. That there's so many lines in that movie that my family and I just take to heart, take to the bank, take in everyday life. We love it. So number one, drum roll. Number one Christmas movie of all time. Jimmy Stewart. It's a Wonderful Life. Don't turn your radio off right now. Don't get out of the app. Don't shut me out. Hear me out. Don't shut me out. It's a Wonderful Life in black and white, by the way. They tried to remaster it in color, and it waters it down. I'm just telling you, if you ever take any advice from me in this podcast, watch It's a Wonderful Life with James Stewart, Jimmy Stewart, as we in the business like to call him. And it is tremendous. It's from like the 1940s, I think. I mean, it is actually maybe earlier than that. But no, it is tremendous. Frank Capra is who made that movie, did that movie, and it's a classic. So I got to break down this guy. I got to break down It's a Wonderful Life for you. The character, main character, Jimmy Stewart's character, his name is George Bailey. And I apologize for those of you that already know this by heart and love this movie as much as I do. I hope I'm not losing you. I hope this isn't redundant for you, but follow me, okay? Because I believe we can take some things away from George Bailey. So just to break this movie down for you, like George Bailey grows up in a small town, right? He and his brother, like the dad has a family business, a building and loan, savings and loan, and he's always dreamed of getting out of this small town, right? George has kind of been always ahead of his time, this old soul, very smart beyond his years, like always had this entrepreneurial explorer mentality, right? He wants to get out of town. So he wants to go on a trip to Europe. Well, he's got all these plans, and like right before he gets ready to go, his dad dies. His dad has a stroke and dies. And there's a old guy in the town that everybody despises because he's this old miser, grumpy, grouchy, stingy, just tyrant. And he's about to take over because he's a shareholder. He's about to take over this building and loan because the dad dies. Well, the board votes to keep it in the family if George will take it over. So George has to pass on his trip to Europe. He can't get out of town. He's got to take over this building and loan so it doesn't go to Mr. Potter, who is this jerk face guy, right? Who runs everything in the town except this family building and loan. So George stays to run this company. So he doesn't get to go to college. He sends his brother to go to college, who becomes this crazy war hero, crazy all-American athlete. He comes back from college. George says, okay, you go to college, you come back. I'll go to college when you get back, but I'll run the show here while you're gone. He comes back. To his surprise, the brother comes back. He's married. So he can't take over the family business because he's already in his in-laws' business now. He's committed to his wife's dad's company. He's going to work for him. So now George, guess what, is stuck in the same rut he's been in. Can't get out. Like, he's shackled to this town, to this building and loan. He hates it at this point. He's resenting the family business because he can't get out now. So he's tied to it. He watches all of his friends going, doing things, making all this money. He's barely getting by. He's married. He finally gets married, has a bunch of kids. They're barely scraping two nickels together. He stays there in this town all of a sudden that he can't escape, right? So he's coming around Christmas time, and they're getting their stuff together. The auditor's coming in. The bank examiner's coming in, make sure they're on the up and up, right? Everybody's doing things ethically. They misplace like $8,000. The crazy uncle, the brother of his dad who passed away, the uncle is helping him run the business. He's kind of lost his mind. He loses this money. So that's red flags everywhere with the bank examiner in town, right? He can't, like, there's all kinds of impropriety, question marks, red flags, and they got to find this money. Well, they can't. So George kind of takes the rap for this. He doesn't want to throw his uncle under the bus, but his uncle's just, he's lost it anyway. He's just a crazy dude. So George is like at the end of his rope. He's starting to unwind. Like, he's starting to let this really get to him. He's starting to lash out at his family. He goes home like Christmas Eve night. He's freaking out. He's breaking stuff. He's flipping out. So he leaves. He goes to the bar, you know, he ties one on and he starts feeling this whole depression of, starts wandering around town, and he's considering killing himself because his life insurance policy will only pay, right, if he's not alive. So in order to pay his debt and take care of his family, he's thinking this is his only way out. So you guys might know the rest of the story. Before he jumps in this river of freezing cold water, a guardian angel jumps in who's been watching his life this whole time, watching George, guardian angel, taking care of George, kind of watching his life. George jumps in to save this guy. So all this time, George has been taking care of everybody but George. He saved his brother's life when they were young. That's how he kind of lost his hearing. So his brother goes on to be this huge war hero athlete, but George saved his life when they were little. So all these things, all these people's lives have turned out to be great all because of George, but George doesn't see that. George is just caught up in the rut of, he can't make ends meet financially. He's ruined. Legally, he's ruined. He's going to go to jail. Like, his family is just crumbling. So he sees no way out other than to take his own life. Well, this guy jumps in, this guardian angel jumps in, George saves him. So he takes him on this journey throughout the rest of the movie to get to see, because George wanted to, he wished he'd never been born. And so, you know, hocus pocus, the guardian angel makes that happen. They get to go through life, walking through town, seeing all these other people's lives had George not been born. If he hadn't been born, he gets to see what happens in all these other people's lives where he impacted them when he was around. So he goes, and, you know, of course nobody recognizes him. You know, he's invisible sometimes. And then when he talks to people, they don't know who he is. So he's never been born. He gets to see this unfold, and he doesn't believe this is happening. And he questions the guardian angel, but really the guardian angel says something key is, George, you've been given a great gift, a chance to see what the world would be like without you. So that's what I want to talk to you about today. If I haven't lost you already, I hope I haven't. How do we get you in touch with your George Bailey? How do we get you in touch with a guy who gets to see his life and the impact he has made? So thankfully, nobody out there is considering taking their own life or is at the end of their rope like this. This is just a metaphor, guys. But sometimes what is applicable is getting caught up in thinking we haven't made a difference, or getting caught up in thinking we've only scratched the surface on our potential, on our dreams, on our purpose. Sometimes we get wrapped up into thinking that we really haven't amounted to much. That's a scary place to be in. That's a slippery slope. I've been there. So what I want to talk to you about too, and I'm going to talk to me too, is how do we get in touch with George Bailey, our inner George Bailey, this guy that gets to understand his impact without having to see his life without him in it. So that's what I'm wanting to get to you today. Three ways we can recognize that it's a wonderful life. So you might think on the surface, this is a gratitude message, right? This is a, you know, just be grateful for what you have, all these, and it is, but it's a little more than that. So listen, hear me out here. Three ways that we can recognize it's a wonderful life. The first one I would say is, like, we have to realize that what we have, but not what we're missed out on. I feel like in George's life, he feel like he missed out on everything, all his dreams, his exploring, his adventures, his trips, his school, all these things he wanted to do, build things. He wanted to be an engineer, an architect, and never happened. So he missed out. He has this whole list of things he missed out on in his mind, instead of looking at all he built right under his nose: family, friends, a community, a business that he didn't let die when his dad passed away. Like, all these things, we as people, we get wrapped up in looking back. Oh, the good old days. What a terrible expression. The good old days. That alludes to the fact that you've already pass those by, or they've passed you by. You experienced the best life has to offer, but it's in the past. Untrue. Every day can be better than the day before. The future can be the best that's yet to come. I have to listen to those words too. But what I'm saying is, we don't have to get caught up in the things we miss out on. Why don't we just magnify what's right under our nose that we have? Those things that are in our life that we have impacted, our kids. You don't realize the seeds you're planting. Maybe you don't ever get to see some of the harvest from those seeds in other people's life, but in your own home, look no further than the love you give your family, the children that you have, and how you're pouring into them and training them, how you're making them different than what the world says. And if you're a believer, and I hope you are, how you're planting spiritual seeds within them. You've shared Christ with them. They're going to heaven. Their eternity is sealed because of you. That should be enough right there. But we have to realize and focus and magnify what's right in front of us, because we have a lot to be thankful for. We have a lot to be proud of. We've accomplished more than we think. Start writing a list of the things you've done. Okay, that's the first one. We realize what we have, not what we've missed out on. That's the first way that we get in touch with our inner George Bailey and recognize that it is a wonderful life. Number two, realize our significance over success. We are so fixed on this report card of life and all the boxes that we didn't check, all the accomplishments that we had down but we never got to do, all these successes, finger quote successes, that the world sold us. This idea of success equals dollars, success equals status, success equals toys, success equals big house, multiple houses, trips to foreign lands, whatever, That's what we've bought into, that success is. What about significance, though? If we grade ourselves on that report card I was telling you about, and we've checked all those boxes and we've been successful, when we're on our bed, our deathbed, at the end of this journey, where are those? Where are those things? Those things that we were so proud of along the way, where is that? Or are the people around us part of the significance that we've had? We've played a huge role in those people's lives, and they're sitting at our bedside when we take our last breath, right? The bank account, the banker, the loan officer, the boat salesman, the travel agent, the vice president of the corporation that you just, you know, that you got a promotion in, they're not going to be there. So I'm going to say, realize the significance over success, because that's how we really and truly sink our teeth into what we call a wonderful life. It's not called, the movie's not called It's a Successful Life. It's an accomplished life. It's a popular life. It's a influencer life. Like, it's a wonderful life. So you define wonderful however you want to define it. I'm going to define it based on the significance I have and the people that I help and the seeds I plant and what I give, not what I take. Where I invest and deposit, not where I withdraw. So that's one that I think is important. So again, three ways we're recognizing this is a wonderful life. Get in touch with your inner George Bailey right here. Okay, that's number two. The third thing we need to realize, small victories over the need for magnificence or monumental milestones. Monumental milestones are great. Milestones are awesome, right? We accomplished this. We hit this rung on the ladder. We climbed to this top of this peak on this mountain. Great. Nothing wrong with that. But we get so locked into thinking we've got to be crapping lightning bolts with every step we take. Everything we touch has got to turn to gold. Like, if we don't, then we're not significant. Or we're not magnificent. Our victories along the way compile small victories. That creates a winning season. And the season is life. So to have this wonderful life we're talking about, a person just needs to accumulate a bunch of small victories. A person just needs to move the ball down the field, move the chains. You know, if a football team just focused on the 10 yards that's in front of them to get that first down, right? Move the chains another 10. If we just focus on those 10 yards every time, you do that enough and you're in the end zone. We get so focused on trying to throw this Hail Mary on first down when we only need 10 yards. So we're throwing this Hail Mary after one after the other. And when we don't hit that big bombshell, then all of a sudden we're defeated. All of a sudden we're a failure. All of a sudden we fell short. Of what? Fell short of what? Whose expectations are we living up to? We're hard on ourselves, but we're trying to live up to other people's approval a lot. And unfortunately, in George Bailey's life, he was watching everybody around him have the life he didn't have the life he planned to have. But because he was focused on helping other people and making an impact within his family, his town, and just doing things the right way, he missed out on some things, but he's looking around at all these people that are going and doing these things he thought he should be going and doing. But he had plenty of small victories right in front of him. Healthy children, happy wife, successful business, people in town who he's helped, being in this building and loan business, all these people that couldn't afford a house, but he gave them a loan. Like, he made sure people had roofs over their head and food to eat. And I get it. That's Hollywood, right? It's a movie. It's not real. I get that. But break it down into reality. Break it down to your life. What applies? All the people around you, all the mouths around you that you're feeding, all the people in your world every day that you interact with that are a little better today because they met you or because you helped them. Your wife's a little bit happier today because you actually love her. Those are not lightning bolt moments. Those are not miraculous, monumental milestones, okay? But those move the ball down the field. Those move the chains every time. Like you get up every day and you've just moved the chains again, another first down. Eventually you're going to get in the end zone a lot. So look, I'm telling you, we can learn a lot from George Bailey. And whether you agree or not with my assessment of the top five Christmas movies of all time, whether you agree with or disagree with It's a Wonderful Life being number one, hands down, unanimous, don't even look it up. Just trust me. Whether you agree with any of that, we all have a George Bailey inside us that felt like we maybe missed something or felt like our best days are behind us or felt like we aren't as successful as we should have been. But guess what? If you take a good, long, hard look like he did, you'll see the significance over the success. You'll see what you have, not what you missed out on. You'll also see plenty of small victories that stack up into a winning season, a winning life. In fact, stack up into a wonderful life. With that, be blessed and Merry Christmas.